I'm here today as a humble student, hoping to learn from the wonderful people who are going to talk to us today. And to open is Dr. Kumkum Shrivastava. Now, many of you may already know her. She was born and brought up in Old Delhi in the midst of a composite culture. And she had most of her schooling in Karachi in Pakistan, where her father was in Indian Airlines. And there she learned not only Urdu and Persian, but also imbibed the cultural ethos of Islam. Completing her schooling from Presentation Convent in Delhi, she graduated and post-graduated in history, specializing in medieval Indian history from Indraprastha College for Women in the University of Delhi. For her MPhil and PhD, both from the University of Delhi, she read social anthropology and carried out an historical and empirical study of the Sufi order of the Qalandars, publishing several articles on these themes besides her much acclaimed book, The Wandering Sufis, which I'm very happy to say that I hope to start reading from today. And this was published by Aryan International in collaboration with the Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya, Bhopal. One of her articles on the Qalandars was recently published in A Leaf Turns Yellow, a book that Muzaffar Ali has edited. She is presently an associate professor at Janaki Devi Memorial College of the University of Delhi. And besides the study of Islam and Sufism, she has worked on the history of Urdu and Urdu poetry, medieval Delhi, Punjabi folk songs, Muslim women, and Mughal architecture. So you can see she has a huge field of interests. She has carried out many heritage walks in and around Delhi and has written and lectured on these topics extensively. I would now like to call on Dr. Kumkum Shrivastava to come to the podium.
Good morning. A very, very warm welcome to all of you here. I was expecting a lot of young people and a lot more women, being International Women's Day today. Anyway, to all the women present here and to the men, happy Women's Day. I think we outnumber, we thought we'd outnumber the men here today, but anyway. I work extensively on the Qalandars. I've worked on Matka Peer and Delhi, and also Abu Ali Shah Qalandar of Panipat. And my today, when we hear everywhere around us, whether it is this morning at in FM 91.1, Meeka Singh blaring out this number, Honey Singh rapping on this number, all the stereos, you know, the cars passing by playing this song. I've heard it so very often, you know, the Mast Qalandar number. The children are singing it. I've heard it in ladies' Sangeet programs. Very recently, on the 23rd of February, I saw this being performed at a Kirtan. Which was held just before the wedding. There was a kirtan, and all the ladies requested Sai Bhavani, the singer, to sing Damadam Mast Qalandar. After having read that, heard those performances, they also handed out a booklet on the Punjabi Sangeet Day, 23rd February. They handed out this booklet. And I was going through it. I mean, they said it'll make it easier for everyone to follow this particular number because everybody knows Punjabi folk songs. You know, Latthe Di Chadar and what else. But they might not know Damadam Mast Qalandar. Anyway, I went through this little booklet and I found on page 25. It had so many mistakes. In fact, Sakhi Shahbaz Qalandar was written as Satish Shah Qalandar. I thought Satish Shah would be immensely pleased with that. You know, he's one of our very popular comic actors and characters in films. So, you know, and, well, the rest of them was absolutely, in fact, you can see my underlining. And so here I went around, you know, asking them, do you know what you're singing? And they said, no, we prepared this, so please, you know, would you come later and talk to us? They were about, it was a Sufi theme night. There were these young boys and girls all prepared to dance. And they did a performance on this number. I asked them what they were, this was my, my brother's son's wedding. So naturally, I was very much involved, and I said, you didn't even bother to ask me. I worked on the kalandars all my life. You didn't bother to ask me what it meant and what you were performing and the words that you were singing. So they said, yeah, we know who the kalandars are. They go around with performing bears and monkeys. Madari. They go around with, you know, conjuring tricks and all that. I got a real shock of my life because I thought, you know, after having heard the Mast Kalandar song, the Mast, or singing or hearing the very famous popular, song from a very recent movie, Highway, or even the movie Jawani, Ye Jawani Hai Diwani, with Ranbir Singh and Rekha Bhardwaj and Tochi Raina singing Tu To Hai Ik Mast Kalandar, Tez Hawa Ka Ik Bavandar, Kya Hai Tere Man Ke Andar, O Faqeera Manja. You know that popular song. All these, since I teach at the University of Delhi, I have had the opportunity of attending all these cultural festivals of various colleges. My husband was principal Hindu college, so we had the Mecca festival and we had, you know, all these singers coming. And each one, whether it was recently Arijit Singh or it was Harshdeep Kaur, you know, adding a ting-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling to Roo Kat Di Phira, you know, that song from, again, from Rockstar. They really had no idea. They didn't even know that the Qawwalis, you know, were part of the Mehfil-e-Sama, of the Sufis. They had absolutely no idea. And how it started, where these Qawwalis started from, who are the icons of the particular, why are the kalandars mast? Why Ali has the pehla number? Damadam mast kalandar, Ali dam dam de andar, Ali da pehla number, Sakhi Shahbaz kalandar, and then Jhule Lalan. Sehwan da, Sindari da, Sakhi Shahbaz Kalandar. Now, Sehwan is a place where Shahbaz Kalandar's shrine is. He came from a place, in Central Asia. His full name was Lal Usman Marwandi. He came from a place called Marwand in Central Asia. And why have, there were so many interpolations, so many additions to this particular most popular Qawwali of all times. Whether it is Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan taking it to another level, or the Wadali brothers, or Runa Leila singing it, or Abida Parveen, and now recently Mika Singh with Times of Music, under the Times of Music label, with rapper Yo-Yo Honey Singh. One side, you know, Mika Singh is performing, is singing the original as the, it was actually, they say that Amir Khusro had written it first, and that he was, and then the Persian version was written by Bu Ali Shah Kalandar. And then the Punjabi version by some additions were made by Bulle Shah. And in 1955, I was told that there was a film, you know, called Mast Kalandar. I went to the archives and I picked up this movie. I thought, you know, I'll get an insight into who the Mast Kalandars were. Lyricist Naksh Lailpuri, music director Hansraj Behel. I was disappointed. It was about a madari. It was about those going around with, you know, conjuring tricks, jugglers and all that. And then I went and looked up at the Anthropological Survey of India, the census reports, and I found that they had also mentioned the Kalandars as a community, as a tribe of nomads, as a community which went around with performing bears and monkeys, and they had their own argot and their own justice system. And H.A. Rose in 1919 had written that they made excellent pipe bowls. That was the only information I got. And then I, you know, worked around it. Why are these people called Kalandars? And even now, even till yesterday, when I visited the dentist, I was reading my book, you know, preparing for the lecture for this day, and he asked me, he said, why do you want to go around, you know, working on the Madaris and the Kalandars? Why do you want to work on them? I said, do you have no idea? He said, no. So today I thought I'll give you an insight into who the Kalandars are, why this particular Qawwali has become so very popular, and what is the, you know, the popular idiom behind who the Kalandars are. And today, since, you know, I have taken the place of somebody else today, I'm supposed to lecture tomorrow, but I will, you know, just today concentrate on the etymology of the Kalandars and the conceptual philosophy, you know, behind the this litany in praise of Lal Shahbaz. I'll go into the history, actually the etymology of the word Kalandar, then the history of the Kalandar Silsila, and the kind of Qawwalis that were performed there. Who are they? They have been so very much popularized by Hindi cinema, by the theatres, by, as I said, all the Qawwals. And after, the most popular term after Sufism, as you know, is Kalandar. No Sufi evening, no Qawwali repertoire of the Qawwals is always contains this litany, Damadam Mast Kalandar. And so the central imagery of Sufi music and songs, the Kalandar, is actually an idiom, a term that is used for somebody who is beqaid, benawa, beparwa, who is antinomian. In fact, they are called unruly friends of God, the rebellious Sufis who don't follow any social conventionalities, who don't follow any norms, who don't follow any you know, compulsory Muslim rituals, whether it be namaz or you know, roza or even hajj. And but the most identifying mark of a Kalandar is that he is mast. All the young people sitting here, mast doesn't mean somebody who is very hot and sexy. Or like in Bombay, everything that you eat or drink or do is, if you like it, it is must. So this is not, this musti, this ecstasy, it is rapture, it is delight, it is unmindfulness. It is a state of being one with him. That is what the Kalandars feel about musti. Anyway, so he's not in his senses. He's a madman. He's unaware. He's also a renouncer, a faqir, indifferent to the world and its normative order. But in the Arabian Nights, the Kalandars are butt of jokes, because initially they moved around with shaven heads, beardless, no eyebrows. It was a practice called char abru safaya. And they went around. Richard Eaton, in his book Sufis of Bijapur, says that he saw them going around naked. They were begging monks, that they were in the state of ecstasy because they imbibed barbiturates, you know, like, you know, bhang, ganja, charas, that they smoke opium and that they drank wine. And then, but besides all that, Digby, Simon Digby has worked extensively on the calendars of the 13th, 14th century. And very recently, I mean, as recent as 1998, Claudia Libeskind worked on the contemporary calendars, silsilas of Kakori, UP. And Ewing has worked in 1979, very brief mention of the calendars. But nobody has really worked extensively on them in detail. So that's why I decided to pick this topic up. Since they are peregrinating, since they are wandering, since they don't have any settled abode, they don't have any settled khanka. So there, wherever they stop, you know, whenever the night comes, they stay there. They go around with a kashkul, a begging bowl, with an ustara, because, you know, in case they need to shave their hair. And then jawal doz, it's a sewing needle, to sew patches on their robe. And their whole philosophy is, Dunya mein hoon, dunya ka talabgar nahi hoon, bazaar se guzra hoon, talabgar nahi hoon, kharidar nahi hoon, sorry. Dunya mein hoon, dunya ka talabgar nahi hoon, bazaar se guzra hoon, kharidar nahi hoon. So this is actually their philosophy. But they are still a part of the Sufi system. Now, Sufis have been divided into two kinds, Beshar and Bashar. Beshar are those who are beyond the law, because Sharia being the law, the Bashar are those who follow the law, and Beshar are those who don't. And in, these are the Sufis who are, the calendars are those Sufis who are antinomy, who are beyond the law. And also, in terms of their dress, in terms of their behavior, in terms of their whole demeanor, in terms of their philosophy also, and their, they follow a different pattern. Whereas the Beshar Sufis, the Bashar Sufi silsilas are individuated, you know, based on the founder, your Qadri, Shattari, Firdausi, Naqshbandi, Sohrawardi. These silsilas were founded, you know, they have a founder and all the murids, I mean the peer or the sheikh as it's said, and even, you know, the Chishti silsila, they have started with a founder, one person. They're individuated. But the calendars are, they used to earlier travel in groups. The like-minded people for whom ishq, the, you know, divine, love for the divine beloved was the essence, they all got together. And in fact, Bruce Lawrence, in his definition of Qawwali, has said that Qawwali is a dialogue between a human lover and a divine beloved. And this is exactly what the calendars follow. And there, where did this word calendar come from? Was it from the Spanish word kala, which means pure gold? Or from the Greek kalator, the truth workers? Or from kalantar, which means large or great? Or in Persian, you know, it also means thief. It also means ugly. It also means ungainly. So was it because they were uncouth and, you know, ugly looking that this name was given to them? Or did it come from the Syriac Ebrani name for God? Whatever the etymology be, whatever its meaning be, but now it is very much linked with three concepts of their philosophy: love of the creator, love of his fellow beings, but no love for material things. And he's intoxicated, as they say, by the tranquility of the heart. And it is that is why they're so much involved in loving God that they forget to love themselves. And now, this is as I mentioned, that this word is encountered, was encountered for the first time in a Rubai by Tahir Urian, where he says, I am a wanderer whose name is Kalandar. I have neither home nor goods, nor kitchen, no country, no lair. When day comes, I wander around the world aimless. When night falls, I lay my head on a brick with a pillow, with a stone as my pillow. Now here, you know, I'll come to the second part of the word. Beside Kalandar, we have must, as I said. Must means full of ecstasy, totally involved in a frenzy. And this ecstasy is created by music. It is created by the reciting or singing the words of the Quran or litany in praise of, you know, the Sufi, the saint, their leader. It could be Lal Shahbaz Kalandar, it could be Bu Ali Shah Kalandar, it could be Abu Bakr Tusi, where they say, Baba ke dar jo mangna hai, mang lenge Baba ke dar se. And at Bu Ali Shah Kalandar's Dargah also, they are the first, you know, they begin with singing praises of God. You know, you have the Naat or you have the Hamd, and then you have the Munakabat, and then you have the. So it starts with, and this clapping of hands. Nizamuddin Aulia had once said that this clapping of hands releases him, you know, from a lot of negative energy, creates a positive energy. And but he also mentioned that he had been to Abu Bakr Tusi Matka Pir's shrine, but the Takiya. And there was a Mehfile Sama going on, and he was not enjoying himself. So he said, there is something missing. And he came back and spoke to his murids, and he said, I found something missing. So I must tell you that in cave, whenever there is a Qawwali performance or a musical performance or a Sama, three things should be taken into consideration. First of all, who is the listener? Akhwan. They must share the same body of thoughts. They must be ham khayal. Secondly, and then with this, he said they should give their full attention to the words of the song or the hamd or the naat. They should give full tawajjuh to what is being said. Secondly, you should see where it is being sung. Where is the Qawwali being sung? The makan. Now, makan doesn't mean house, it means a place. He said, the site of the Qawwali should not be close to the place of residence. It should not be close to the mosque. There should be no distractions. The third requirement of a Qawwali at a Sufi person's khanqa, the third thing that you should consider is the zaman or the time, the zaman. It should not be dinner time. Otherwise, if you're hungry, then you will not be able to either sing or listen to the Qawwali. It should not be prayer time, because the call of prayer will naturally take you away. And or if you continue to stay there, then you will be missing one of the obligatory prayer times. And thirdly, it should not be too late. It should not be nearing bedtime. Otherwise, you will all be yawning and not pay much attention. So these are the three and conditions for a Qawwali performance. So that means that at Abu Bakr Tusi's takya, at his place, these three things might not have been followed. Because for them, any time was song time, any time was dance time. And in fact, the Al-Ghazali had said that it is not necessary to just sit and sing in a mehfil sama. You can also dance, whirl, and jump. So the Mevlevia order of Jalaluddin Rumi followed, and Shams Tabriz followed this practice of whirl, dance, and jump. And therefore they are called whirling dervishes or dancing dervishes. But surprisingly, I don't know, you might have seen so many performances. Jodha Akbar film, Khwaja Meri Khwaja, or even Mera Ishq Sufiana. I don't know, that particular Ishq was not Sufiana, let me tell you. Vidya Balan in her fattest best. And of course, they had these girls and men, even in Khwaja Meri Khwaja, wearing those tall white caps, a white long frock, something similar to what Manjari is wearing today in black. But the whole idea behind wearing this long khirka or robe, it was, why white? In Egypt, the Rifais, one of the Calandria silsilas, so akin to the Calandria silsilas, the Rifais wear this white, they call it tenure, which means shroud, kafan. So they've given up on the world, they've already dead to the world, the concept of fana. So the Kalandar's philosophy is all about fana, fana'i fillah, dying to one's self, and baqa'i billah, but living with God. So fana, the concept of fana is not what Amir Khan told Kajol, ki main tumhare ishq mein fana ho jaunga. So it's not dying for your beloved, it's dying to yourself. Your basic instincts are annihilated. Your basic lower instincts, those are annihilated. Everything, when you are not there, when the ego, the self is completely destroyed, then what remains? Baka. What is bakaya? He says, even let that baka, let what remains be with God. You must have all heard, luckily, lakri jal koila bhai, koila jal bhai raak. But when you burn the raak, what happens? Raak. You keep burning the raak and still something remains. So, O Lord, says the Kalandar, let that bakaya, let that baka, that whatever remnants, the residue, even that, let that remain with God. That is what visal is all about, union. And this state of ecstasy, this vajd, will lead to, you will love. So it will begin from ishke majazi. If you don't love a human being, that is the first stage of loving God. Rabia Basri, who's supposed to be one of the Dhai Kalandar, the first one being Abu Ali Shah Kalandar, then Lal Shahbaz Kalandar, and the women equivalent. I'm sorry to say, today being a woman's day, half. Rabia Basri was regarded as half a Kalandar, being a woman. So Rabia says that I love God so much that I have no time to hate Satan. And here is, this is the essence of the Kalandar thing. That is why they are in this state of masti, in the state of ecstasy. So we come now to damadam. Now what is the meaning of damadam? Damadam is not, Manjari will tell you, anything to do with any musical, sound or something. Dam. Dam means breath. Dam means life. And one of the sister silsilas, you can say, tariqas of the calendars, was the Madari, founded by Bahuddin Madar, Shah Madar, Burhanuddin Shah Madar. And it is believed that, and the founder of the calendary silsila, Aziz Makki, to whom Ali, Prophet Muhammad had, it is said, was also a kind of a calendar, and this philosophy he handed over to his son-in-law, Ali, and then passed on. The person who brought it to India was, besides many other names, but Aziz Makki. It is said that he's not dead. He lies in a state of habs-e-dam, breath control. And he is buried in a, Sardaba. Sardaba is a very kacha grave, kabr, not tarmacked over or lined over bricks. And he is, this state of breath control, pas anfas, is also a practice followed by Moinuddin Chishti. He used to carry on chillai maqus, upside down in a bell. And also by Nizamuddin Aulia, Sheikh Nasiruddin Chirag, Dehelvi. And so this is the whole idea of, they followed it from Aziz Makki or even Shah Madar. There, a legend goes that Prophet Muhammad, seated on his horse, Burak, flew Miraj, and he went off to the gate, landed at the gates of Jannat. But he could not enter because the gates of Jannat, the eye was just as small as the eye of a needle. And he was perplexed, he was worried, he was, disturbed. So the angel Gabriel came to him, Jibril, and said, "What is the matter?" He said, "I cannot enter the gate is so small." So he said, "That's no problem. Why don't you take the name of Shah Madar and call out Dam Madar, Dam Madar, Dam, and you will see that just by taking his name on the breath of Madar or on the life of Madar, the gate will open." And so it happened. So anytime, so if you'll find that these Madaris, this followers of Shah Madar, they walk on fire. One of the rituals at their urs is walking on fire, even at Lal Shahbaz calendars, Darga. And they, all of them shout out loudly, "Shah Madar, Dam Madar, Dam Madar, Dam Madar." And all, even the porters, when they're lifting their load, will either say, "Ya Madar, Ya Ali, Madad Ali," or they will say, "Ya Madar, Madad Madar." So this, the idea of, controlling the breath probably, is one of the ritual exercises which they perform and they remember. So Damadam Mast Kalandar, Ali Dam Dam Deyandar, Ali Da Pehla Number. Ali is supposed to be the first Imam, the first Sufi, and the first calendar also because of his philosophy, and the calendars regard him. In fact, Bu Ali Shah calendar said his name was Sharfuddin Shah, but the term Bu Ali, which means the fragrance of Ali, he says was given. The legend goes that it was given to him by Ali, that he was doing his austerities, practicing his austerity, standing in the middle of the river. The fish had eaten most of his flesh. And suddenly he saw an old man, and this old man pulled him out of the river. So he said, "Why have you pulled me out? Why have you saved me? I'm not going to come out of the river till I meet Ali." So he said, "Well, I am Ali." And to say that, he took out some saliva from his tongue and placed it on the in the mouth, on the tongue of Bu Ali, on Sharfuddin. And from then on, he came to be known as B-double-O, Bu, Khushbu, or Bu, smell or scent or fragrance of Ali. So this whole Ya Ali, you'll find that every Sufi, whether it is a Qawwali or a song or something, will have Ya Ali, Madad Ali, Maula Ali, even, as I said, the recent Rehman song, and they all have Ali in their songs. So this is because Ali is supposed to be the first Sufi, the first Qalandar, the first Imam also, and also the first, and the founder, you can say, of Sufism. This is what it is believed. Now we come to Lal Shahbaz Qalandar. Lal, because it is said that he wore a red palash or dress, which was red in color. Also because it is said that copying Ibrahim, it is said that Ibrahim had once sat in a pot, which was placed on a fire, and he turned a red color. And here it is said that Lal Shahbaz also did the same. But his name was Usman Marwandi. Where did he get this name Shahbaz from? It is said that once he rescued, because of his high ideals and high philosophy, and he had reached a certain level. So Bahuddin Zak, once he had rescued an old man from the stake, an old religious mendicant from the stake. So Bahuddin Zakaria, it is said, another very famous Sufi saint of Multan, said that he gave him this name, Shahbaz. It's a falcon. So Shahbaz. And if you, Pran Neville sir has visited Pakistan many times, and I used to see this, the picture of Lal Shahbaz. And this the Mast Qalandar written there, and below that Shahbaz Kare Parvaz Jane Raz Dilande. So you'll have trucks, beautifully decorated, and with these, and you'll have calendars and posters, and behind, like we have a Sher written behind the autos. You have in Pakistan, I've found trucks beautifully decorated. And with this image of Shahbaz flying in a falcon and knowing Raz Dilande. So I've just come to the last, I'm taking so much of your time, but you have to know, all the words that you're singing and that you're hearing. So we've started with Damadam Mast Qalandar, Ali Dam Dam De Andar, Ali Da Pehla Number, Sakhi. Sakhi means a one who has a large heart. Sakhi Shahbaz Qalandar. So the word meaning of Shahbaz also is clear. Jhule Lalan. Now where does the Sindh saint, Sindhi, icon, Sindhi saint, Jhule Lal come into the picture? Where? National integration, sir, or fusion. A composite culture. Sindh was ruled by Miraksha, the Muslims had come in, and there were so many Hindus there, and they were asked to convert. They didn't want to. They were asked to leave. How could they leave en masse? Their whole livelihood, their whole life had been spent there. So some of them, went besides, they were sitting beside the river Sindhu, Indus, and prayed and prayed and prayed for some miracle to happen. Because Miraksha had given them very little time. And while they were praying, they saw a boat coming, and there was a kind of a prediction. Somebody came to them and predicted that there would be a child born who would, take away all their sorrows and all that, and who would deal with this problem, who would help them sort out this problem. So they went to the Sultan, and the Sultan said, okay, I'll wait. If you say so, let's see, how will the child be born? So it did happen that this child was born. And his name, they call him Udairo Lal also, or Darya Shah. But Jhule Lal, it is believed that when he was born, they placed him in the jhula, and the jhula started moving on its own. So this little child came to be known as Jhule Lal. Lal means a child, the Lal, the son of. And then he, the Sultan was naturally, struck by this miracle, the karamat. And he said, okay, let's wait. Let's see what he does. But it so happened that he grew up and he finally led the Sufis and formed a separate, they formed a separate identity. And so he also became an icon of the Sindh. So Jhulelal is therefore also remembered, not as part of the Kalandar like litany or Kalandar, you know, but as a part of the whole area of Sindh. You know, he was a saint of Sindh. And Sindh Lal Shahbaz is also, so this started off, you know, initially by the local people when they, so there are a lot of interpolations, a lot of additions, a lot of subtractions to this particular Qawwali, which has become the item number of every Qawwali performance. You cannot have a Qawwali performance unless you recite this one. And you're asked to. So the, you know, they keep adding. Initially it could be Uchara Roza Pira Tera Het Vage Darya. And in Multani as well as in Sindhi language, Vala means again. You know, when you repeat something, you say Val, again. You know, Val, what happened? Next, what happened? So you say Vala or Val. So, Jhule Vala, Sindhari Da, Sehvan Da, Sehvan is the place, Sindhari is Sindh. Phir Hind Sindh Pira Teri Naubat Baji. In Mika Singh sings, Janana Janana Teri Naubat Baji. Some other Qawwal sing, Dar Pe Pira Teri Naubat Baji. Okay, fine. Now, Char Charag Tere Balan Hamesha, Panjwa Main Balan Ayo Vala. If you see the gender, this thing, it is a woman. You know, or her, it's like the lover and the divine beloved. So it's this time it is a woman. It's in the feminine voice. Panjwa Main Balan Aya Vala. Aya is, you know, if you, those who are here, Punjabis, you know that agar aadmi bolega to aya bolega na, and if the woman speaks is ai, so it's aiya wala Jhulelalan. Now each the murids or the people who are singing, they add, how will their saint become popular? You have to talk about the karamat, you have to talk about the miracles that he is able to perform, so this is added. Maava nu pira bachre denda, paina nu denda e veer mila. So what can the, this saint is so miraculous. I mean, he has so much karamati, he has so much power, you know, to appeal that attraction that people have towards that, because he's able to perform miracles. And what are the miracles that he performs? He gives children to the childless. Bu Ali Shah Kalandar is known for that. He gives children to the childless. The lost, you know, makes the lost mother, brother and sister come together. And so this part is also added. And many, many more, you know, are added according to where it is being sung. If it is being sung at the shrine of Bu Ali Shah Kalandar, you have many more, you know. Jo mango milega peer baba se, to jholi phela ke to dekh. So they add that along. And today, I end with another addition. Mika Singh is singing, Damadam Mast Kalandar. And Honey Singh will sing, Allahu, Allahu. And then, Mera Din Vitu, Meri Raat Vitu, Meri Roo Vitu, Meri Zaat Vitu, Mera Mera kafir tu, mera qazi tu, mera rusya tu, mera razi tu. And I had just picked it up right now, I mean, when I was coming in the car in the morning. And so you have, you know, these additions, the rap now being added to this particular Qawwali, which has become, as I said, the icon song or the item song of the Kalandars and the Qawwals all around the world. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Kumkum.